Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Hopefully you're able to find a seat today. It's great to see everyone here. Man, it's windy outside. It doesn't feel good when you walk out there. Thank you all for being here today. I know that we are, I wanted to start off by saying we're keeping in close contact with city officials about like what's going to be happening in the next weeks ahead, and we'll communicate thoroughly to you on as far as what's happening, what's not happening, things like that. There are things coming up that, you know, just get ready, we might have to cancel. It just all depends on what the mayor or the mayor's office is saying to us, but we're gonna keep moving forward until they tell us otherwise. So, but with all that being said, thank you so much for being here. It's great to see all of your bright and shining faces today, even though it's not bright and shining outside. And if you look around, you'll see the connection card around you. Please go ahead and fill that out. There's information on the back as well for you to fill out. We'd love to get your information and follow up with you accordingly. If you have any questions as well for us, or things that you want prayer for, put it on the back of that card and drop it in the offering basket later on. As we get started today, I invite you to go ahead and stand, and we'll go ahead and pray together and continue. Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you that you are a God who loves us, and you have been making such effort throughout all of creation since the beginning to get to know us more and more and more. Help us to grow closer to you. We love you, Lord. We ask that you be with us as we worship. In your name we pray. Amen.
To God and praise and love. 5. We have been made right with God because of our faith. Now we have peace with him because of our Lord Jesus Christ. Through faith in Jesus, we have received God's grace. In that grace, we stand. We are full of joy because we expect to share in God's glory. And that's not all. We are full of joy even when we suffer. We know that our suffering gives us the strength to go on. The strength to go on produces character. Character produces hope. And hope will never bring us shame. That's because God's love has been poured into our hearts. This happened through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. The song is called Blessings.
What if you're here? As many know, we are in the process, me and my family are having a house built. And one of the things the builder has let us do, and actually my parents were able to do this with their home that they built as well, the builder has allowed us to go in and with a Sharpie on the plywood and on some of the beams, as long as it doesn't interfere with the little notes of the workers and all of that, allowed us to write prayers and scripture on the wall. And we thought that would be kind of a neat thing, you know, so that is kind of a part of our household, hedge of protection type mentality on that. So we went in there, and me and my wife took turns, and we wrote different prayers, different blessings over each of the rooms. One of the things that I did, I drew a little cross in one place that was kind of, under the staircase. And there was this one particular spot, and by the way, a lot of them were either scripture or just general prayers. Every once in a while, we might invoke the name of Christ on a particular area. This particular area, if you go up the staircase, it takes a little turn, and there's just this wall right here in the corner. And I wrote the phrase, "May Christ always be the cornerstone of our household." So I thought that was important to kind of go in the very middle of the house. You know, what the essentially the most load-bearing part of the house to write that. And, you know, we felt good about that. And we went along with our day. Well, the other day, Kara went back to just see what kind of progress, see if they put anything else in the house. And under that phrase, in the middle of the staircase, as it takes a turn, nice flat piece of wood right there, "May Christ be the center, the cornerstone of our household," under that, someone had either snuck in or maybe the workers and wrote, "Hail Satan." And it was one of those things that just made your heart sink. And when I got it, I just thought, why would someone do that? Why would someone, you know, even if they know Christ, even if they don't, I doubt that they do if they're writing that, obviously. Why would someone be so mean to do that? And I was just kind of in a bad attitude about it. You know, it's very something very minor in case, but it's kind of big, too. I had, after I kind of got over it a little bit, I said, well, why don't I kind of edit it to say, "Hail Santa," and draw a little Santa next to it. And I'm not going to do that. We're just going to go ahead and mark it out. But my thought process quickly turned when I started to think about the fact was that there was an unbeliever reading the name of Christ right before that happened. And there was something within that unbeliever that name of Christ was so abrasive that they had to do something about it. Praise God. I hope the name of Christ is abrasive to those who are perishing. Because it causes us, when we hear the name of Christ, it causes us to think twice. And it causes us to consider repentance. That the power in the name of Christ does things. It physically manifests things into reality. We didn't see that anywhere where we wrote like generic prayers like, you know, "Lord bless this home," and, you know, over each of the kids' bedrooms. And sometimes we mentioned the name of Christ, sometimes we didn't necessarily in context and all of that. But when the name of Christ was used, that's when the abrasiveness came. There's power in the name of Christ. So we're still not exactly happy about the fact that someone wrote that, but I'm happy to know that someone was able to read that before they did it. So maybe even after they did it, they can go home and think about it. Maybe it was a kid, maybe it was a worker. We don't really know, but The fact is when we give ourselves to Christ, we become different type of thinkers. That we don't resort to anger in so many cases. Anger that leads to sin is what I mean. Indignation, maybe. Injustice, we're angry about that. But today, I wanted to talk about this passage. We're going through this whole story about the shipwreck with Paul. Paul was a man, if you've read anything about Paul, who, you know, he was converted drastically from being a persecutor of Christians, who there was abrasiveness every time he heard the name of Christ. Oh man, I can't. He heard it so many times that you could just imagine that it was just boiling within him. And then finally, he had an encounter with Christ. So today, and then that converted him, and he became a follower of Christ. Today, I wanted to go back and rewind a little bit as we talk about this lost at sea, ministering in the midst of danger. In our story, Paul is on a ship with a lot of people, a lot of sailors, a lot of other prisoners. And they are sending him to the island of Crete. If everything's going according to plan, the island of Crete, so that he could be imprisoned, so that he can be away from everyone. So I wanted to stop and go back a little bit and first get in the mindset of Rome. Why are they sending him to Crete? Just south, I believe, of Greece, if I have my map right in my mind. And it's a very remote place. You see, if Rome was so mad, the Roman Empire was so mad at Paul for what he was doing, why don't they just kill him? Well, the answer to that is kind of simple. It's because of his influence, there were so many Christians around the Roman Empire world, the known world at the time, that what would happen if you killed the most influential figure in Christianity? Well, according to the Romans, there might be an uprising. Who knows? We don't know what they'll do. So let's instead send him to the island of Crete, remote, far away. People have to take a boat and have a lot of effort to get there to be able to see him, get him away, no resources, maybe some food here and there. He'll have to fend for himself. But we're going to allow people to go see him. Because, for all we know, he could be dead, you know, unless you send some friends over so they can kind of give the thumbs up and say, well, yeah, he's fine, he's doing well. But what we find out is that in the times where the Romans did that, people were bringing him food and resources. He was stronger than ever. He was able to actually get, papyrus and be able to write letters and send them out. And the Christian church was growing like wildfire, even though Paul was imprisoned. So let's send him somewhere remote where that becomes a little harder, right? Paul's desire in his whole ministry, one of the biggest things that he wanted to do was go straight to where the Roman Empire, the very heart of the Roman Empire. And that's Rome. So getting closer to Rome is bad for the Roman Empire, great for Paul. So Roman Empire tries to send him to Crete, which is about as far away as you can go in retrospect. So they're sending him on this ship to go out there. And then when they're in this ship, the storm begins to rage. We can picture it in our minds. Look outside right now. The wind begins to rage. I was walking from the coffee shop this morning, and I felt like a human kite. You know, I felt like I was going to just get swept away. There's one time where I was pressing the button to go across the street, and it was pushing me into the street. I said, no, thank you. So I had to step back a little bit. So imagine that wind times 100, because here in Scripture it says it's the biggest, what they call the nor'eastern, the biggest gust they've ever seen. So they get in the ship. Paul tells us, and we've seen this in the last few weeks, Paul tells them, like, if you're going to survive, don't fight the wind. Put up the sails, allow the wind to take you where it's going to go, wherever we crash, wherever we go, start anew from there. Who's going to listen to a prisoner, though? He's just going to manipulate you. He wants out of this whole situation, right? It doesn't make any sense for us to just sit down and say, well, Paul, what do you think we should do? Because he's a prisoner. Come on. So they fight against it. And the boat begins to kind of twist and turn and bash up against some rocks. And in this particular passage we're reading, they put down what they call a sounding, which is just a long rope to see basically how deep they're in. And more and more they fight it. More and more Paul is sitting there saying, hey, I keep telling you what to do. I'm not trying to manipulate you. I'm just telling you how to survive. So finally, we see a twist in the story here in what I'm about to read to where they start actually listening to Paul. Well, this guy's been right every time. Why not? I mean, come on. The storm is raging, and at this point in time, we've already read through the fact that we're in the midst of this storm. Lightning, thunder, there's wind, big waves. They've put rope around the bottom of the boat to hold the thing together. They're just desperately trying to do anything that they can. So, they start listening to Paul. Today, I want to talk a little bit about Paul's mentality. Paul, and this is just a little spoiler alert, Paul wasn't even remotely concerned with his own safety. He didn't mind that things were not going well. He wasn't in this mentality of self-preservation. He wasn't thinking about, oh, what am I going to do to survive? He was thinking about the 276 people there with him. 276? I believe I got that number right, yeah. So, there's one thing I want to point out at the end of this, that if we can gain anything from this story, it's this little concept that I'll tell you here in just a moment. But, we're in the midst of the shipwreck. Right now, it's been 14 days they've been in this storm. You can imagine, like, I can stand a storm for maybe a day. Just things going on, and you can just imagine that all of them, their emotions have already dried up. Like their voices are, they all have laryngitis because they've been screaming. They're tired. They've been running on adrenaline for maybe the first couple of days. Now they're hungry. They're tired. They've already thrown some food overboard to try to lighten the load a little bit. I want us to get in this mentality. We have to. So, here we are, starting in Acts chapter 27, starting with verse 27, actually. On the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea, which is just south of, like, Italy area. When about midnight, the sailors sensed they were approaching land. They took surroundings and the soundings, and found that the water was 120 feet deep. A short time later, they took soundings again and found it was 90 feet deep. So they're just dipping the rope in there to drag along the rocks. Fearing that they would be dashed again against the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending that they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved." So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it drift away. You see, they're already listening to Paul now. Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat for the last 14 days. He said, "You have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You will need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head." After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all, and then he broke it. Does it sound familiar? And began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves. Altogether, there were 276 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. We'll stop right there. Very interesting. So here's Paul telling them, hey guys, you guys need to eat something. You haven't eaten, you've been running on adrenaline. This is what I'm paraphrasing here. You don't know what's going on. You've been emotionally drained. You need to eat something. In fact, let me help you with that. Right before this, they were going to get out the lifeboats. They were sneaking over. The soldiers and sailors were over here like, hey, let's get some lifeboats. Let's get out of here. But Paul says, no, I'm telling you, if you cut those lifeboats, everyone's going to die. Or if you get into those lifeboats. We need each other to survive. So a miracle happens in that they actually listen to Paul and they say, okay, we'll just cut the lifeboats free and we'll stay here. They had no plan B. They had nothing to fall back on. They had to trust that Paul and his God were going to get them through. But I want you to, and this is the phrase that I, or this is the concept that I want you to gain from all of this. Paul, in the he's around these centurions, he's around the soldiers, he's around the 276 people who are against him. Then instead of his self-preservation, he chose to serve and minister to them. That's profound. It wasn't about me and my preferences and my comfort. Paul was looking around to the 276 other folks that are standing around there, how can I be Jesus to them? And the implication that that's what he was thinking was in the exact wording that we hear in the Last Supper, that he broke bread, he gave thanks, and he distributed it. We know he was trying to be like Jesus, and he said his default mentality was not trying to look out for himself, but his default mentality was being like Jesus. These people hated him. I guess in a storm like this, when you're all in the boat together, everyone's kind of, no one's enemies with each other, you know, at that, for a little while. Everyone's trying to figure out what to do just to survive. We can save our disputes for later on. We can save our arguments. We can save our hatred for one another for later on. But right now, we got to get through the storm. And while everyone is running around in circles, where, I mean, in theory, because the boat was packed full of people, you can only run so much, you know. And in the midst of all of this chaos, Paul, acting like Jesus, was calm over the chaos. And instead of, how are we going to survive, Paul looks at all of them and says, how can I serve? It's amazing. It's amazing that Paul was able to do that even in the midst of all of that. These people knew for a fact that they were going to die. I mean, in their minds, the circumstances dictated that they were going to run aground. They were going to die. They went from 120 feet deep, and then they went to 90 feet deep. I mean, it makes sense that the next thing that they would do is run aground. They dropped anchor right there. They tried to hold steady to where they are. And they finally looked at Paul and said, well, what do you got? You seem to be calm. You seem to know what you're doing. He was concerned about the fact that they had not eaten. That they were tired and weary. These were the same people. Are we getting this? These are the same people that are about to throw him in prison for a long time. That he cared about them. Cared about their needs. There is something upside down about that mentality. And when we think about it, we think about Jesus, who had the same upside-down mentality about the kingdom of God than what we would think. He's sitting there, if we talk about Jesus, he's sitting there washing Judas's feet. He's looking at this guy who's about to betray him by sending these soldiers in so that he would eventually be crucified. And Jesus even says, hey, sit down before you go. I want to go ahead and wash your feet. He sits Peter down, and they have an argument about whether Peter is worthy, quote unquote, about getting his feet washed. Peter is about to deny him three times. I don't know this guy. I've never heard of the disciples. I don't know what you're talking about. One of the deepest betrayals. And he washes his feet. But there's something about the kingdom of God that doesn't seem right to us sometimes. That the people who offend us, the people who are against us, the people who shake their fist at us, the people who yell insult at us, the people who write Hail Satan on our houses, and the people who dislike us, and the people who are anti us, that we are still called to reach out a hand to them and say, I love you anyway. That doesn't make any sense. When we are hurt, we get angry. Have you ever stubbed your toe and gotten angry at the side of the bed that you hit it on? You hit it. Oh, wait, there's no one to get mad at here. Sorry, this is a little side note that I laugh at myself at sometimes. Have you ever like hit your elbow against the dresser and you, for some reason, say sorry real quick? Oh, wait, actually, no. There's no one to apologize. Oh, sorry. Wait. There's something about fear. There's something about pain. And there's something about suffering that automatically drives us to anger. But the kingdom of God teaches us a new way to handle that. It's this upside down kingdom that says the answer to fear, anger, should be love. Sometimes love means discipline. Sometimes love means caring for that person, binding the wound of those who hurt you. And it's a different mentality entirely. It's not a doormat, don't stand up for your rights. No, you know, that's not what we're talking about. It's not allowing injustice to happen around us where we're like, well, you know, let me serve you while you hurt another person. That's not what we're talking about. What we are talking about is this release of self-preservation so that we can act as Jesus to other people. Do you think that Jesus was all about self-preservation? He cried blood and sweat blood in the Garden of Gethsemane, just begging God if there's another way that we can do this whole crucifixion thing. Is there like a down payment I can put on this? Is there some other way? Can I write a letter to someone's manager? I mean, can something happen here other than what's about to happen? But he said, despite all of that, your will be done. He was alluding to this in the Lord's Prayer as well. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And when he goes on in that prayer to talk about daily bread, to give us this day our daily bread, he knows that if we are allowing God to enact his will on earth as it is in heaven, we'll be cared for. Paul knew that. He knew if he did feeding, he would be fed. If he cared for, he would be cared for. Sometimes I feel like as Christians, we don't really believe that. while it's a great idea in, and I understand it, I understand why they do this. I'm not speaking against this. I'm using it as an illustration. In our Christian mindset, often we have the airplane mentality of pull down the oxygen mask for yourself first and then go give it to someone else. That's great on a plane. And you should do that, like they're telling you to do that. But in the Christian life, it's a little bit upside down. There's this concept that I've written about many a time that essentially says that so many times that we desire to soak up our spiritual experience, that we find ourselves becoming bitter and tired as Christians because we're not exercising the spiritual gifts that we've been given. We're just sitting there on our spiritual couch, taking it all in, and then we wonder why we're fatigued because we don't ever go serve. So, here in Paul's story, we're seeing this amazing and beautiful little snippet. Paul is acting like Jesus because he knows that if he dies, he dies. He knows that he can die and know that the church of God is going to go expand beyond him. And it won't be a revolution because it's not like anybody killed him or anything. It was the storm. But he knew that the God of the universe is still the God over the storm. 276 on board. He could have easily chosen just a few and said, hey, let's survive together, let's take care of each other. But his concern was about not only the people, the other prisoners who were like-minded, but those who were against him. An illustration that I've used many, many a time is this concept. If you've ever seen the movie Hacksaw Ridge, great movie, by the way. This man, he's a medic, goes in, and he's crawling under the bullets as they're flying by to go save those who are wounded. While he's not participating in the fire, he is still participating in the rescue. And I wonder if in our Christian life, sometimes we need to be thinking about that. There's a lot of nonsense that happens on the periphery. But if we're centered in Christ, we're in the right place. I'm going to call the praise team up here. And I ask that as they are playing, you'll just go ahead and if you want to come up here to the altar and kneel, you have some business to do with God. My challenge today is that don't get caught up in the periphery. Center yourself in Christ and he will lead you in the places you need to be. Start thinking about ways that you can serve your enemy. Pray for your enemy. Find ways that Christ can be seen in you in the midst of suffering, fear, and pain. They're going to sing. I invite you to the altar. And we'll go ahead and reflect after. Seeking you real.
news worth repeating this morning? Somebody does, I know it.
Thank you for your prayer. My mom survived her surgery yesterday. There was great concern that she might not because of the extent of her heart problems. But she did, and she will live at least a little longer. Praise God.
Anybody else?
Do the service today. Spoke to my heart. I took care of my mom. But I came to this church. I see it over and over again. I'm so sick and tired of hearing me say it. I was a total yes. And it just came dear on me. Nobody asked me. It was somebody else. Except the Lord could eat this assignment. So I had to look at it that way and say, yes, Lord. But I thought it was no fear. There was no pain. The suffering. And I still did not want to do what I had to do. But I was wrecking my whole life. But through that time, through the 6 years that I took care of her, to the very end, when I came to wash her feet and her body, and to care for her every day, I no longer thought about me. I just did it in the air. But I had so much compassion. And when she came up, then I looked and didn't know how to take care of myself. Because I took care of this. So I'm learning now how to take care of me. But you just do it. You don't know how you do it. And then it's over. And then you try to pick up and go again and say, where do I start? Thank you, Pastor, for the message.
Thanks, Hannah. Thank you all for sharing. God hears us when we pray. I think sometimes we need to know that other people are praying too. And something about that just lifts our spirits, right? It's one thing to pray ourselves and know that God hears, but something about knowing that other people are praying. So don't hesitate to reach out if you need a prayer, because that's what we're here for as a family, as a church family. Before we pray and close, and Pastor Landon comes to do that, I just want to share one quick announcement. Once again, this year we plan to have poinsettias for the stage. That is, again, as you mentioned, assuming that we continue to gather here for worship. So last year we ordered 10 poinsettias and gave you the chance to designate those in honor of someone or who's still living or in memory of someone who's passed on, and make a donation to the church for those poinsettias. And then once we're through the Christmas season, you can take those home with you. Simply cards will be available for you to fill out and put on your poinsettia, and donations you can make to the church. So we'll have some more information about that in the coming weeks, but just wanted to give you a heads up that that's coming.
I want to go ahead today and end this service with prayer. And I ask that as you go from this place that you will find excuses to love your neighbor and love those who may seem against you or against Christianity or whatever the case may be. Because that's how we proclaim the name of Christ, through our actions, through our words, through who we are. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to be here. Thank you for the seasons that we experience in our lives, the physical seasons we see outside. It's not not the brightest, it's gray, and we might not like it, but we know that it's a part of your grand plan. Help us to be people who are faithful to you, despite what the circumstances are on the outside. We love you, Lord. We give you all praise. In your name we pray. Amen.
Joy still comes in the morning, hope still walks with the hurting.
For worshiping with us today. Don't forget that you can submit prayer requests to us through our website at www.fisherspointcc.org. You can also continue to give financially by mail, on our website, or at the church. Also, we would love if you would subscribe to our YouTube channel and like us on Facebook to stay up to date on all services and other announcements. Have a great week!